Konnichiwa, guys, and today I want to share with you what are the 50 things that you definitely want to know before arriving in Japan. I just got back here to Bali, Indonesia after doing 2 weeks traveling across Japan, and this is an incredible destination that you're absolutely going to love, but there's a lot of things that you definitely should know before you arrive, and that's why I wanted to come back to Bali, take a couple of hours to write down some of those things that would have helped me from the start of my trip to make sure that you have them for yours. With 50 things, we got to move quick, and so I'm not going to be diving completely into every single one of these points, but I also have several other Japan videos that will have been posted or are soon to be posted. So make sure to check out the link down below for the other videos or just hit the subscribe button because there's more videos to come. Point number one is to always carry your passport with you. The reason is, as a foreigner, you're actually exempt from taxes on purchases if you could prove that you don't live in Japan. So whether you're buying cosmetics, a pair of running shoes, or as I did, a Switch, well then just present your passport on checkout and then they'll actually completely waive the tax, which is an awesome system.
Hey kids, you want to buy a Nintendo Switch? I got games.
Number two, if you've seen videos of Japan, you've probably seen a lot of people wearing these masks. Now, what's with the masks? Well, it's actually an incredible courtesy move. In most cases, it's actually Japanese people who are not feeling that well that day, and so in order to keep the germs to themselves and make sure that things don't go airborne, they wear these masks to not spread viruses, diseases, etc. I think it really shows the respectful nature of the Japanese people, and it actually looks pretty badass. You can pick one up for yourself if you want to get a cool photo. Now, I'm just saying, if there was an airborne zombie virus, Japan would by far be the safest bet. So keep that in mind. That's a little bonus tip here today. Number three, wear comfortable shoes. I had one day in Kyoto where we walked about 22 kilometers that day. My feet were aching because I didn't have the right shoes on all day. And that's actually not that uncommon to have a lot of time on your feet walking between metro stations, between destinations. So yeah, enough said. Number four is some quick metro etiquette. The first thing you should know is you shouldn't be eating on the metro. The main reason is it's just a bit disrespectful to the others around you. Secondly, you're not allowed to talk on the phone. It's actually a bit strange to a North American, but when you get on the train, you'll see how quiet it is and it'll all make sense to you. Number five is kawaii. I've just taught you your first Japanese word, and kawaii is the act, the art of being cute. And it is literally a lifestyle here in Japan. The kawaii girls will often have these very like polished kind of Barbie doll style outfits that they wear in public, and they'll even walk with a bit of an inverted duck foot. It's definitely a very unique side of their culture, but kawaii is seen everywhere.
Oh, kawaii.
Meow, meow.
Taxis. They are really expensive, and so they're always kind of like your plan D, maybe even your plan Z. Try to take every other transportation means before a taxi, but they're there in the event that you need them, running 24/7. Now, with that being said, the main way to get around is going to be the metro system. And that is something you'll get very familiarized with unless you're balling out. In which case, then do your thing. The next thing you need to know is that you're literally more likely to see a flying pig than you are to find a trash can in Tokyo or the rest of Japan. For a country that is this clean, I have no idea how they do with so few trash bins. If you missed my Hong Kong video, then this is shaved ice, also known as kakigori. So I ordered a salted caramel kakigori. So what they do is they take a massive block of ice and they spin it around with a very, very fine blade, and it creates this very like snowflake, snow-like texture. And then they put syrup, they put all sorts of toppings on it, and this one is supposed to be the best in Kyoto. Now, once you experience it, you will be envious that your country doesn't have a train like it. It is the bullet train. Traveling around 325 kilometers per hour, it's about a third of the speed of your average plane. It can get you from A to Z in no time. And the amazing thing about it is you don't have the inconveniences of flight. You don't have to go through security checks. You don't have to deal with the annoying check-in process. Everything is much more streamlined. It's just slightly more time consuming than your average metro check-in. And the amazing thing too is once you get on the train, you got all the seat room you need. You've got a big desk, you've got outlets to plug in your computer, and it makes traveling luxurious and comfortable. Now, while the JR bullet train is definitely a great way to get around, it's not as cheap as your local metro, but it's a lot cheaper than flying. So this is where I wanted to share with you a travel tip. If you know you're gonna be in Japan and you're gonna be jumping around a lot, I'm talking going going Kyoto to Osaka, Osaka to Fukuoka, this is where you should look at something called the Unlimited JR Pass. I think it has a different name, but basically you can buy different time frames of unlimited ridership. So you can have a 7-day pass, a 14, a 21-day pass, but it's important that you know this because you actually save a lot of money by buying it in your hometown. If you live in the US, they will ship it to your house, but you have to be organized enough to order it in advance. Because we were on the road, we did not do that. And so our friends coming from the US had already bought it. It was about $200 US for a 7-day pass. And in the end, it saved them about $50 on the itinerary that we traveled together. For us, we went to Japan and we tried to buy it in Tokyo, at which they were charging us almost $300 US. So we saved $50 by not buying it in Japan. So if you can be organized like most people are before a big trip, make sure you order it to your place and make sure you do a bit of route planning because it might make sense not to buy it at all. A bonus tip to be included here is that if you're actually gonna buy a 7-day, 14-day pass, whatever you get, make sure you initiate it at the right time. Yes, you can use the JR pass the moment you land in the Narita airport and take a train downtown Tokyo, but what if you're staying in Tokyo for the next 3 days? Now you've wasted 3 days of not using that pass. For my friends, it made sense to just activate their JR pass right as they were leaving Tokyo to begin our journey down to Kyoto. The next point, Suica. Suica is bay, Suica is life, Suica is mood. Suica is this green little swipe card that allows you to get through the transit gates just with a quick tap. It's completely free, it's just a 500 yen deposit, which is roughly $4 US, but the amazing thing about it is you have machines all over the metro stations to keep it filled, to keep it topped up, so that way you can make sure you're quickly tapping through gates, you're not holding anyone up, you're not individually selecting your stations. It knows when you get on the train and it knows when you get off, so it automatically bills you the correct amount. It's such an amazing convenience. And the best thing about it is, for those early morning rises, you've got your vending machines all over the train stations that accept Suica. So with a quick tap, you've got yourself a cold coffee or even a hot coffee. Yes, the vending machines do serve hot coffee. I don't know how more of the world doesn't have it, but I'm envious. A little side note, there's also a card called the Passmo card, and that's just a direct competitor, but I'm more of a Suica man myself. Number 12, food should be one of the main excitements of coming to Japan. Now, you may think to yourself, oh, I'm gonna eat a lot of sushi. The truth is, you're probably not gonna eat much, you might not even eat any. Sushi as we eat it in North America is not actually how they really eat it in Japan. Yes, you can find your traditional rolled sushi on a conveyor belt or, you know, some fine 5-star delicious cut of salmon, but oftentimes they'll have it in more of a nigiri sashimi style, which is absolutely incredible. Even if you're not a fish person, give it a shot. You'll be very blown away by how amazing and fresh the ingredients are. There's such a pride taken behind all of the meals you'll have. Even at the more budget and mid-tier, you'll still see a pride and an effort to make the best meal possible. And that's something I respect so much about Japanese food and the people there. If you're not gonna eat sushi, what are you gonna be eating? Well, the first thing is a lot of ramen. We ate so much ramen. It's a delicious wheat noodle, kind of typically a bit thinner. With your noodles, you'll have a bunch of meat broth, and inside of there, there's different flavorings based on the kind of soy sauce used. You typically can get boiled eggs added, as well as the most delicious tender pork. It really adds a lot to the flavoring, so if you're not a vegetarian, you gotta try it with pork. Now, quite similar to ramen is udon, and udon is a bit more noodle focused. So what you've got here is these wheat flour noodles, but this time they're quite a bit thicker, and they're also served up with some broth, again, some soy sauce, and the toppings are pretty similar. I mean, you've got pork, you maybe have some chicken, you've got all sorts of different things from scallion to different seafood that you can add with it. A couple other noteworthy mentions are gonna be donburi, which is a rice bowl. It's delicious, typically topped with pork, with rice. I mean, rice is the base, but we ate several times at this restaurant right here. The name is below, and it is delicious. For $4 or $5, you have a meal out within 5 minutes. You're eating it, you're ready to go, and you're on your day in Japan after a great meal. It's fantastic. You also have a couple other legendary meals, like an omo rice, which we had at the most interesting restaurant I've ever been to. This guy was a serious character.
Hello, nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet
guys,
you.
This right here is the chef. He's a celebrity here in Kyoto.
Arigato.
Arigato.
And
he is arguably, probably factually, the best omelet chef in the world.
Yeah. My name is Yukimura Motokichi.
And the ever so noteworthy Wagyu beef. It is my favorite style of beef. When you have a steak done right, it will be one of the ones you never forget. And the last thing I want to say is the amazing thing about Japanese food is that it's typically quite healthy. If you look around, most Japanese people are actually quite slim and fit, and the main reason is because of their diet. Now, an extension of that is our next point, and that is that you can find amazing food at convenience stores. You'll be able to find nigiri rolls, you'll be able to find udon bowls, all sorts of ready-to-go food that you can have within a minute or 2 minutes of checking out, and it's pretty healthy for the most part. And it's probably where we ate 50 to 65% of our food.
We got sandwiches, we got wraps, we even have some boneless fried chicken.
Convenience stores were our life, and they saved us a lot of money too. Number 14, Japanese people are known as driven, hardworking, respectful, but what you might not know is they're the most pleasant people we have come across in our travels. They will go the extra mile. Now, I literally saw that in effect, because the Japanese people don't really speak English very well. In fact, most people won't even speak basic English, but that does not stop them from trying to help you. In a couple instances, some people walked over 100 meters out of their way to show us where a bathroom was, to show us where the right turn was so that we could get the right train. People will just go out of their way to help you even when there's a communication barrier, and that's something that I appreciate so much and something that made this trip unforgettable. Sometimes you gotta read between the lines because Japanese people will make sure to avoid conflict, and they are so respectful that sometimes it can be hard to read what they're really thinking.
Pretty nice, hey?
Number 15, a bit of a combo point. As I mentioned, there's a massive language barrier. Not everyone's gonna be able to speak English. And that is where having my phone set up was a game changer. It was almost a necessity, in my opinion. For 9,000 yen, about 81 US dollars, yeah, a little pricey, I had unlimited internet. That meant I could be streaming YouTube while on the metro system. That meant I could make sure I had my Google Maps with me at all times. I could Yelp the nearby best coffee shops or pancake house. Whatever I was feeling was at the disposal of my fingertips. For me, I think it's key to have your phone set up. Even if you go for a cheaper plan, around half the price, maybe $35, $40, you can have a limited amount of data, maybe 2 to 3 gigabytes, that should be more than enough to do the basics like mapping, like finding out where the nearby coffee shops are. And because Tokyo is so massive, because there's such a language barrier, that phone will definitely help you out on countless occasions. I got my phone set up at the Narita airport, and from my limited research, it didn't seem to get much more expensive outside of the airport, so maybe just do it there to have your phone ready to go throughout the trip. Google Maps, it saved our butts many times, but I must say it's not completely accurate. Many times it would bring me within 50 meters of accuracy. It's better than being in the wrong city or suburb, but it's still wasn't deadly accurate. Sometimes it would point one direction when you actually had to go the other. So sometimes just treat it a bit more like a map, become a master cartologist, and start figuring out where you really are. It showed us what transit stops to get off on, to get on. It gave us rough estimates of how much time it took to get from place to place. So yeah, having your phone set up, again, it's crucial. Number 17, and this is the most important point. Subscribe to Lost LeBlanc for more Japan travel tips, and watch the other videos. Point 18, you need to know about pachinko. Pachinko is this like slot machine, but on like LSD. It's the craziest machine you've ever seen. You'll play it and you'll have absolutely no idea what's going on. But if you go to the 1 yen machines where each ball is worth 1 yen, you're not really risking that much. You could probably play for 15-20 minutes and at the worst case lose 20 bucks. If you're lucky, you might just win 5 bucks or even 20. Another thing you should know is that it's actually perfectly legal to drink here on the street in Tokyo and in Japan. And it's super easy to find. You can go to your convenience stores, you can go to grocery stores, and basically you don't even have to present ID.
So, gompai!
Number 20, safety should be on the back of your mind. This is one of the places where you could travel as a solo backpacker, whether you're a girl or a guy, and not even think twice about it. Yes, of course, be safe wherever you're traveling, but Japan has to be one of the safest places on planet Earth. We literally saw 8-year-old kids on the metro system alone getting from place to place in massive cities like Tokyo. So if that doesn't say enough, then I don't know what will, but you can feel completely at ease. Just practice logic and you will be fine. Number 21, tipping. It is not required. So if you're taking a taxi, if you've just finished your meal, the amount that they've billed you there is the final amount. Do not tip them. I don't know if it's true or not, but I've heard it's a little disrespectful to do that. And oftentimes, if you ever left extra money, they will chase you out of the restaurant to bring you back your money thinking you forgot it. So it's really not part of the culture. Don't worry about it. 22, pods. This is the cheap way to do Japan. Pods are these incredible inventions where it's basically like a claustrophobic person's worst nightmare, but it's a budget backpacker's best option. Basically, you've got yourself a tiny little cocoon that you call your bed, but when you're backpacking, when you're trying to travel and see places, this is all you really need. Yes, by day two, day three, day four, it might get a little bit tiring to, you know, have to bump around, go downstairs to the lockers to get your stuff, but it is saving you a lot of money. And Japan can be expensive. Pods can be found through most of the large cities in Japan, and I think it's gonna become more of a trend across the world. I hope for it. Now, with that being said, if you wanna learn more about the experience of pods, check out my Weirdest of Japan video, also gonna be linked down below, to see what it's really like and really all about. Okay, this tip is a big one. Don't forget your cash. In Japan, you would expect that such a modern and developed country would just have tap to go with your credit card everywhere you go. But the truth is, most of your mom and pop shops, restaurants, and even some businesses that will shock you will not honor credit card. You will need a lot of cash with you at all times. 24 is something by the name of Sakura. And Sakura is when we travel to Japan. It is the 2 week period in which the cherry blossoms blossom. And so you have a very tiny window where thousands and thousands of people from around the world will all flock to Japan at the same time. Now this is a great thing because you get to witness Japan in one of its most beautiful states. The negative though is that it also drives up the prices. Less selection in hotels, more competition for activities and everything else. So this is definitely an expensive time to see it. And if I was on a budget, I would probably just come during the summer. But if you have the luxury of seeing it, it is truly beautiful. But I have to say, the cherry blossoms were not as widespread as one would expect. They were definitely in some very beautiful pockets, but you have to kind of travel out of your way to go to those cherry blossoms. It's not like they scatter across the entire city. All right, we're halfway there. Rules are black and white. Now, what does that mean? It means that the other day, Kathy and I were in Kyoto and the streets were absolutely empty. It was midnight and there was this one lady on her bicycle waiting at the red light where there was literally just an alleyway that no car would ever cross by. She waited there until the light went. We walked across and from there, as we were crossing by her, we got a bit of a dirty look. It's not that Kathy and I don't respect the rules, it's just that sometimes we like to bend rules. And in Japan, that's not really a thing. So just be aware that people take rules very seriously in Japan, and if you try to go around them, outside of them, you might offend some people. You might not be that well liked. Number 26 is something that we did not get to check out, but I wish we did. It is called the onsens, also known as the bathhouses. And basically, these are places where people will come to relax, to enjoy some hot pools of water. Now, there's a couple things you need to know about onsens. And the first is that often, if not always, you'll be separated men from women. There's separate onsens for both sexes. And from there, you also need to know that you'll be going completely nude. Everyone will be stripping down. And one more thing to add to that is if that you have tattoos and people can see the tattoo once you're nude, well, you're probably not gonna be allowed into most onsens. In fact, you can be kicked out. So it's something to know if you're going to an onsen and you have tattoos, make sure you're going to a tattoo friendly one or book a private onsen where nobody will be able to tell. Travel with friends that you get along with. I traveled with Melissa, with Alejandro, with Michael, traveled with Marilla, and with my beautiful girlfriend, Katy. Number 28. In Japan, it can be very disrespectful not to remove your shoes when entering certain places, such as certain restaurants, such as temples. The best way to be aware of it is just to look at what others are doing. We really didn't see that many places where they remove their shoes, but just be aware that it is a big deal and it definitely comes back to respect. Number 29, you will try their toilets and you will never want to leave. Japanese toilets have it going on. They spray your bottom, they sing you a song, they give you noise so that you have privacy, and they have a heated seat. There's so much more about it, but if you want to check it out, it's in my Weirdest of Japan video. Number 30 is one that kind of blew me away, and it's the fact that walking and eating at the same time is deemed disrespectful. Now, this is a bit more of a traditional Japanese mentality, and apparently it is slowly phasing out, but if you're to walk and eat, especially on the metro, you might offend some people. The next point, high-speed internet is everywhere. The internet is so fast. It's allowed me to keep all my files uploaded while I was on the road, which almost never happens anywhere in my travel. It made me so happy. Like, I'm talking uploading 100 to 200 gigabytes in a matter of like 8 hours, depending on what internet you're on. But fast internet was pretty widespread. Many restaurants will have public Wi-Fi, and so will some cities, but it wasn't widespread enough that I didn't want to have myself a SIM card. So again, I do recommend having that set up. The next point is smoking is pretty widespread in Japan. Places like pachinko parlors and certain restaurants will actually not have any separation between smokers and non-smokers. Number 33, Japan can be very expensive, but it can also be relatively affordable. So that again will come down to you and how you practice your budget management. So if you're taking the metro, if you're sleeping in the pods, if you're eating donburi rolls for $4 to $5 a meal, you'll be able to keep your costs moderately low. If you're going to be going to shows, staying in hotels, taking taxis, this can be a very expensive trip for you. Now, the most important point that you need to know is that there's a lot of little cute dogs all over Japan. Again, I don't know what you're gonna do with that, but just keep that somewhere back there. Register it in there somewhere. It's important. The next thing you need to know is that as good as it is to travel by metro in Japan, it's actually a little bit challenging if you're packing heavy. It can be really challenging to find the lift, to find the elevator. It's kind of hidden sometimes, and they have those walkways for blind people everywhere. And so these pathways that are meant to help people who can't see very well get around actually become very challenging when you're dragging around your luggage. We did a lot of jumping around from Tokyo to Japan to different places in Tokyo. We broke many sweats. That was probably our best workout we had when we were traveling around Japan. Just one thing to keep in mind, that if you're staying in one city, it's best to stay in one place because moving your luggage, it's a bit of a pain in the butt. Plugs are the same in Japan as they are in North America. So basically, you've got the one that looks like this, just two parallel lines. 37, there is free water with all of your meals. Service water is completely complimentary and no restaurants should refuse you that, so keep that in mind. 38 is that tap water is drinkable. So again, more money saved. We don't have to buy water bottles because that's a real expense when you travel to most countries in the world. The next point you definitely need to know, because if you're first time traveling to Japan, you might think that you're getting ripped off, and that is table charges. It's basically a cover charge to go eat in a restaurant. Now, the slight bonus of a table charge is that even though they might charge anywhere from $3 to $5 per person to sit in the restaurant, it typically comes with a small something, whether it be like a bruschetta or a little tiny croissant. Usually it comes with a little something that's not worth the money, but it's their way of enforcing a bit of a higher spend per person. Another thing that they might build into that, they often have minimum spends on certain restaurants. So what that means is sometimes they'll actually enforce that you buy a certain amount of items. We went into a coffee shop and they told us we had to buy one food item and one drink. Don't get misled by low prices on the outside, because when you add in the minimum spends, when you add in the cover charge, the table charge, it might become a lot more expensive to eat at that restaurant than you first expected. Okay, the next point. Waiting in line for food became part of our life and I hated it so much. I wanted to eat good food and I wanted to eat it now. But most places, even the places that didn't seem all that great and exciting, aka Denny's in Japan, they had massive lines and the food was horrible at Denny's. By the way, don't eat at Denny's in Japan. I feel ashamed admitting we ate there, but we wanted American food that day. For such a large city with so many restaurants, you will definitely do a lot of time waiting in line. And so what I recommend is either getting there early, or best of all, for really popular restaurants, I'm talking like the most popular, you need to make reservations sometimes like weeks in advance. For the semi-popular to popular, you might need to make reservations a day or two in advance. As somebody that likes to go with the flow, I didn't really like that much, but you gotta play by their rules, otherwise you might not get the meals you want. We're almost there, guys. Sake. This is the local alcohol, and it's definitely a really awesome thing that you need to try. It's about 15% to 18% alcohol. It's meant to be sipped, so don't take it like a shot. And sake is rice-based alcohol. And the cool thing is, it can be served cold or hot. I kind of like it in both ways, but I probably lean a bit more towards the cold sake. Number 43 is to start sleeping in your closet before arriving in Japan, because that is what's gonna mentally prepare you for the rooms you're gonna be staying in, unless you're balling out. If you're like me and you're balling on a budget, then you're gonna be staying in what feels like a shoebox. Tiny, tiny rooms where you sometimes can't even open your luggage. You basically have to lodge it between the small openings that you have. Your bathroom will look like you're inside of a cruise ship at times. It's very tiny and still expensive. That's just the way it is. Not much you can do about it, but as long as you're prepared to be tight in restaurants, in metro, in your room, then you're good to go. The three main cities that I believe are the most touristy are going to be Tokyo, which is the very cool and hip and modern city. Then you have Kyoto. Kyoto is kind of the more traditional side of Japan. You've got the old school Japanese style streets. You have easy access to places like Nara and the Bowing Deer and so many other beautiful monuments and temples. And thirdly, the smaller and slightly weirder competitor brother to Tokyo is Osaka. It is the second largest city, and with that, it definitely has a very unique flair to it. A lot of personality, definitely not quite as picturesque, but if you're a foodie, I've heard this is one of the food capitals of Japan. Number 45, Narita International Airport has to be one of the most distant airports from its city. Because Japan has such high-tech transit systems, you can actually get there in an hour with the next system, NEX, the Narita Express, and it's gonna cost you about $30. Personally, we took the hour and 45 minute route and paid half for our train, even a little bit less, but the next does give you reserved seating, which is nice if you have a lot of luggage, if you wanna make sure that you have a seat, although we didn't have a problem getting a seat on the half price train. If you arrive late at night, you should know that getting into Tokyo won't be possible by metro because the metro system closes, and so your next best bet will be to take a shuttle bus. Still cheap, around 1,000 yen or about $8. It's gonna take you about an hour 45 to 2 hours. The next point is something that's super important, especially if you're planning to do a late night in Japan, a big night out. You need to know that the trains stop running anywhere from 11:30 p.m. to 1 a.m. Super, super early for such a large city, and that's kind of the culture with everything. Many restaurants, the transit system, everything closes pretty early, and so if you're planning to do a big night out far away from your hotel, you could find yourself paying a lot more to get home than you ever expected. With that though, I do have a couple of tips that the Japanese people have taught us themselves. It's either to sleep on a park bench, it's not super uncommon after a big night out, or to simply sing your night away in a karaoke booth, which is quite cheap to rent. That's actually a very commonplace thing that the Japanese people will do in order to cut the cost of getting home. They'll basically just stay where they are until the morning when the train starts running, and then they will go home. If you don't want to be that person passed out on the sidewalk, then just make sure you do a bit of planning. Number 47, although Buddhism is the main and most practiced religion in Japan, the traditional religion is Shinto. And Shinto is practiced by about 3 to 4% of the population. And with that, you should know that there's a difference between a Buddhist temple and a Shinto shrine. They are shrines and not temples. Number 48 is something by the name of Yamato shipping, and Yamato is a way that you can basically take your luggage and you could leave it at a 7-Eleven, a Lawson's, any convenience store, and Yamato will pick it up and bring it to your end destination. Now it does take about a day or two of advanced planning to let them know so that they're ready to pick it up and bring it to you, but if you are in that situation where you're like, how do I get this bag from here to here? There you go. Yamato is the big shipping company there. Number 49, it is very rude to point. And lastly, number 50, if you've made it this far, you're crazy, hit the subscribe button, because if you don't subscribe, I'm not gonna tell you number 50. Number 50 is that you just need to visit Japan, because it's freaking epic. I wanna go back as soon as possible. I think within the next year or so, I'm gonna be going back on another trip. I'll try to explore some of the more distant cities, some of the less traveled locations. Love to see Fukuoka, I'd love to see Sapporo, and so many more places. I fell in love with this country, its food, its people, and I would love to go back when it was a little warmer in the summer. So yeah, there you go. 50 things that have you so much more ready for your trip to Japan. Anyways guys, my name is Christian if you don't already know that, and thank you so much for watching all the way through to the end. Again, I've got all these other behind the scenes Japan videos, the weirdest of Japan, the things that you need to know about Kyoto, and so much more. So if you want the perfect itinerary, take some inspiration from these videos, hit the subscribe button because I make a new video every single Saturday, and this video is getting ridiculously long, so I'm gonna end it here. Let's get lost again in the next one.